To drop Astro off at obedience school on your way to work.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, this is his school day, huh?
I told you all those iconic and in some cases extremely juxtaposing things made their way into one television series about a robot that just really wants a date to the school dance. What if I also told you that the result of that marriage would be one of Nickelodeon's most acclaimed series of all time, and that the network would cannibalize it and throw it in the trash in the most unintelligent ways imaginable?
XJ9, calm down. You're scaring me.
You'd be upset too if you were Rob Renzetti. By the time Rob made it to Nickelodeon, he was an animation staple. He had worked to mold shows like Dexter's Lab, Samurai Jack, and the Powerpuff Girls for Cartoon Network. But when he made his way over to Nickelodeon, it was with an idea in mind. This is Mina and the Count, a pilot and short he had created for Nick in hopes of getting the green light for a series, a show about a girl with a vampire best friend. Nick didn't love the idea, and told Renzetti to come back to them with two more if he wanted another shot at a series order. One was a twist on Mina and the Count. One became a story of a boy with a teenage robot as a neighbor. That neighbor became
Jenny! Call me Jenny! I changed my name to Jenny, remember?
My Life as a Teenage Robot would premiere on Oh Yeah Cartoons in 1999, but would get its first proper episode on August 1st, 2003, and from essentially that point on, the show would be fighting for its life. But not in terms of quality. Jenny, Brad, Sheldon would spend each episode fighting to save the planet and be popular at school. There'd be epic battles and smaller arguments, but its narrative is only a part of the show's successes. Teenage Robot was one of the most stylistically unique animated shows of that era, and it was deeply entrenched in classic science fiction. While Jenny looks a bit like Baby's First Gundam, the show's aesthetic is deeply tied to the works of science fiction that are instantly recognizable, even if you can't articulate or call to mind those inspirations. H.G. Wells, in particular, is a man whose sci-fi novels have inspired more science fiction across TV and film than is comprehensible. His work, and in particular the covers of his work, are everywhere in Teenage Robot. There's no mistaking the influence between Wells' novel War of the Worlds, in which an alien force invades the planets, and the cluster invasion of Earth here. But it's the influence of classic sci-fi films that I find more interesting, like Attack of the 50-Foot Woman, or this alien reference.
Get away from her, you...
Get away from her, you fish!
The show provided its audience a portal into a world of decades of sci-fi that they probably would have otherwise not been exposed to. It was a subtle introduction to the novels of Wells, to the world of cheesy Friday night B-movies, and it gave the show a personality that felt strangely familiar. It sparked an interest amongst its audience in the world of decades of classic sci-fi that so few animated shows tapped into. And throughout this first season, this blend of animated coming-of-age science fantasy about a female robot that smashes asteroids with drills and needs a date for the drive-in that night was not only unique, but it was excellent. There was just one problem. Nick didn't agree. See, Renzetti was someone who believed greatly in the old adage of anything good takes time. He had no interest in rushing his work, yet Nick placed 2-week turnaround constraints on storyboards and tight turn-in schedules on episodes that made it difficult to turn the episodes around within. Yet Renzetti and his animation team continued to make it happen, so there was hope by the end of the first season that this series was headed in the right direction.
Finally, a place where I'm accepted as a friend!
This is the enemy. Traitor to the robot species and monstrous defender of the human world.
Yet its second season would be delayed and wouldn't begin airing, excluding a Christmas special, until 2005. This is important. The first season's 13 episodes aired over the course of 12 months. Simple math, about an episode per month, which slowly and obviously killed any hype around the show. The wait until 05 for a second season, killing that momentum even further. Nick was essentially, very slowly, allowing the show's penetration into the market to disappear. Why? Well, things would get a lot stranger before the network would speak up about it, a trend at Nick. Season 2, however, was more of the high-quality same for Teenage Robot once it did air, and it would stay even truer to its aesthetic. While Teenage Robot tried to stay relatable, it only did so superficially. Sure, Jenny gets grounded and feels as though she doesn't fit in at times, but there's only so much relatability a sentient, world-saving machine can have. Aesthetically, the show plays with this recognizable fantasy angle. Season 2, both sonically and visually, is some of the most interesting work in the series, and it carries that torch over from its first splash of episodes. Everything in the show is what designers and architects call streamlined modern. It's a retro-futurist style made famous more currently by things like the Jetsons. A rounder, sleeker, more metallic vision of the future. Aesthetically, it's kind of like mixing a 50s diner with the realities of every tale about green Martians. The houses Tuck rides his bike past, the UFO that Tuck and Brad steal for a joyride, the cars on the road. Everything is molded in this style, and the sound design is, well...
Robot.
All too overlooked and too little talked about, the sound design of this show drove home its aesthetic better than anything else. And while Jenny would spend the second season battling the cluster in robot puberty, the industry was beginning to take notice of this individuality. Its 43-minute special, Escape from Cluster Prime, was nominated for an Emmy, and the show itself racked up 11 Annie nominations. That aforementioned special, taking Jenny to Cluster Prime after she becomes fed up with dealing with the monotony and realities of being a teenager on Earth. Jenny is painted as the villain and is forced into an eventual showdown to regain control of this planet. It's an episode that encapsulates everything great about the show, the slice of life roboting and the superheroing, and climaxes in an animated battle that would define the series. But then, well, worst case scenario came knocking down the show's metallic doors. Season 3 of the show would be created and finished, and then would vanish. Nick canceled the show at the end of the second season, stating that despite the critical acclaim, the ratings of the show had declined. In all likelihood, this probably had something to do with Nick's sporadic releasing of its first season's episodes, and the gap between that first season and the second, slowly diminishing the intrigue for a show whose premiere had technically come 5 years before in 1999. So what'd they do with the show's third season? They buried it. It would first air in Asian markets in 2006, and for 2 years, that was the only place it would air. By 2008, when Nick finally decided American audiences deserved a chance to see how the show ends, they wouldn't even give the show the Chalk Zone treatment and air it in a dead time slot. Instead, they'd shove the final season onto their Nicktoons channel unceremoniously, finally ending the 7-year saga of only 39 episodes.
Alright, that's it. Hand in your hat.
But
don't make me get rough.
Life as a Teenage Robot is an interesting case study in how the television industry treats its creators and its properties. The clash between quality and numbers. Nielsen ratings are worth something, viewer numbers, but Teenage Robot is a perfect microcosm of the relationship between those viewer numbers and quality. There isn't one. Teenage Robot was a retro-futuristic coming-of-age story about a female machine, and none of that makes sense, but it was phenomenal. I guess what the show taught me, and what it should show others, is that just because people aren't clicking on your video, or watching your movie, or buying tickets, doesn't mean what you're creating, or what you love, isn't great. Sometimes, numbers don't tell you much of anything. Teenage Robot is still loved today because it was loved then, just not by its network. So, if you love something, watch it, buy it, engage with it, talk about it. It just might keep your next favorite talking pubescent robot on TV. That is a wrap on today's episode of Nerdstalgic. If you enjoyed this video and want to see more like My Life as a Teenage Robot on this channel, click the like button. If you haven't yet, press subscribe as well. It'll make sure you get every video on this channel. Also, the bell next to the subscribe button, if you press that, that helps a lot. It makes sure you're actually notified when I upload so you don't miss any uploads. So press subscribe and the little bell. And on your screen right now, to your left and to your right, are two more episodes of Nerdstalgic. And I will see you guys in the next video.